Well, it's good to see you. Next time I see you, Christmas will be done and past. And whether or not you are ready or not, here it comes. As I've been teaching this season, and good to see some of you, by the way. Good to see you. I haven't been in a while. But as we've been contemplating this Christmas season and the message, the Lord had me speak on Advent. And Advent, as we've done the Advent candles, Advent is a Latin word which means basically the coming. And the coming of Christ, of course, was in Bethlehem, that baby coming to Bethlehem, which we were all anticipating the celebration of this Christmas as well. And, of course, the second coming is the second advent of Christ. But as we're thinking of that first coming of Christmas Day, as Christmas is still coming, we're still thinking about Advent and that coming. The Lord gave me some messages about that. And first of all, that a few weeks ago, that we would prepare our hearts, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight, because Jesus is coming soon. The Lord is coming. And then last week, I talked about Messiah, the promised one of the Old Testament who was coming. And again, coming to the anticipation of waiting for the promised Messiah's arrival. And then this week is Emmanuel, God is with us. This is Christmas, the last Sunday before Christmas, so I'm talking about he's here. He's here. The Messiah has come, and he is God with us. So I want to talk about God with us a little bit this morning. Before I go into the first passage of Scripture, I just wanted to be reminded to say thank you so much for Naya on the drums this morning. It was her and Og. Outstanding job. Her first time on the drums publicly here, I believe, and great, great job she did. Didn't want to point you out while you're up there and embarrass you, but what a great job Naya did this morning. But what does it mean, this thing, God with us, Emmanuel, God with us? Are we going to be okay with this? Should I put it out? It's fine. All right. Tell me if I catch fire. What does it mean, God with us? Let me just read the source material for that, and it's Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. It says, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to put her to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying," listen to this, "Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel," which being translated is God with us. That reading we just heard in the Advent reading this morning. "Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took him his wife, and did not know her until she had brought forth her firstborn son and called his name Jesus." So the promise of the Old Testament would be that there would be one who would come and be called Emmanuel. Emmanuel being translated meaning God with us. Jesus coming to this earth is God coming to earth. God with us. Reminded of the song that Will sang, "Did You Know?" And when you've kissed that little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Gets me every time. But to bring it down to understanding just a little bit, my daughter Kimberly, of course, having just moved, she was just a wee tot. Whenever she was in, when we went to church, it's Pastor Sam's church in Tampa. We were going there, attending there. At that time, we had a minivan, and Kimberly was in her car seat. She was probably 3 years old, 2.5, 3 years old. She's riding in the van, and being curious and learning and growing as a child, she was asking questions about God and having a pastor for her father. Of course, she's getting the long lecture, you know, giving her the full thing. And I'm trying to teach her all about how God is everywhere. God is with us. You know, Emmanuel, God is with us, and God is everywhere. He can see everything, he knows everything, and he's everywhere. Said he's over there in those trees, he's everywhere. And Kimberly just all of a sudden speaks up, and she says, "In the van?" And I said, yeah, Kimberly, in the van. God is with us, even in the van, in a minivan, going down Livingston Road in Tampa, as well as right here in our hearts and in our lives and in this very room today. Yes, he's with us. God is with us. So the second place I want to take you to is, that's a good question. Did I mark the second place I'm going to? Yes, I did. In John chapter 3 and verse 16, a passage you may be very well familiar with is that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life instead. God with us means God the Father gives. God the Father gives. He gave the gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, of course, was given gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh at that first Christmas day. We give gifts to one another at Christmas time and kind of repeating that idea of the gifts that the Magi gave Jesus. But do you know that there's another great gift mentioned in the Bible as well? That passage is found in Romans 6:23, where it says, "The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." When I was in Jacksonville in Bible college, one of my jobs on Sunday was to be in what we called the dealing center. We were at a big church that ran 3,000 kids in Sunday school. We ran 80 buses all over Jacksonville and brought in kids from all over, every walk of life, every neighborhood. Brought in, like I said, 2,500 to 3,000 kids every week. My job in one of the dealing centers with third and fourth grade or something was to deal with kids who came in who, after their children's church, raised their hand and said that they wanted to be saved. And so I would deal with them in that dealing center and lead them to Jesus by showing them the scriptures. Now, when you're 23, 24 years old, and you're speaking to a child that's in elementary school, you've got to make sure that what you're saying makes sense. And so I tried to explain some of what that means. Now, adults can relate to the first part. It says the wages of sin is death. You ever have a job? Yeah. Anybody have a job? You work for what? Wages. Not peanuts. Wages, money, yeah. Right. The wages of our sin is death. In other words, we earned what we get coming. We worked for the wages of death when we sin. That's the bad news. Wow, not only does death come to us, we worked for it. Good job. Way to go, everybody. Yeah, overtime in some cases. See, the wages of sin is death, but by contrast, the gift of God is eternal life. A gift is not wages.
That's right.
There are so many people who believe that if they give enough in the offering, or if they give enough at the Salvation Army bucket, that somehow that will buy them some favor with God. It doesn't work that way. Because the wages of sin is death, but the gift is not earned. The gift of eternal life is not earned. How do you get it? How do you get any gift? You reach out and take it. If someone offers it, you reach out and take it. You see, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. God wants to give you the gift of eternal life wrapped up in the present. You know, presents are wrapped up usually, you know, through Jesus Christ our Lord. How do you get the gift of eternal life? How do you get a gift? First, you have to reach out and receive it, right? Someone offers it to you. If you just say, no, no thanks, you don't get it. If God offers eternal life to people, not everybody takes it. Not everybody trusts it. Got such a wage mentality that I didn't earn it, so I'm not going to take it. If God offers a free gift of eternal life, we have to reach out by faith and take it. How do we get it? How do we get to the gift? That's right. We got to unwrap the present. We got to rip open the pages, right? Not the pages. We got to rip open the paper. That's wrapping paper. See, the gift of God is eternal life in the wrapped up person of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You can't get to eternal life without Jesus. It's impossible. He's not a good way to go to heaven. He is the way to go to heaven. There is no way to get the eternal life without going through the person of Jesus Christ. Well, what about that ripping open part? Yeah, he did that. Yes. He did that. We celebrate that with communion. His broken body. It was shed blood for us. If you want the eternal life, you got to get the person. Gift wrapped in Jesus Christ. But God with us. God with us means God the Father gives the gift of eternal life. Emmanuel, God with us, also means that the Son of God understands us. The Heavenly Father gives gift to us through His Son, Jesus, but the Son of God understands us. How do we know that? In John chapter 1, verse 1, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." He was in the beginning with God. And then skipping down to verse 14, it says, "And that Word became flesh and dwelt among us." Who could that be? That's Jesus, right? The Word, in the beginning, the Word was with God, and the Word was indeed Himself, God. And then God put on flesh. When did that happen? Christmas morning. I'd like to say December 25th, but somebody correct me on that. That's fine. It's okay, because I learned this morning that one, you know, man, some people esteem one day above another, like December 25th, and others seem every day alike. Well, that'd be great. I think I'll pick that second one, because that means every day is Christmas. The Son of God understands us because He became flesh and dwelt among us. That means He knows what dust in His shoes and a rock in His shoe feels like. That means He knows what blisters on the heel feels like from walking too much. That means He understands what getting hungry feels like. That means He probably understands what a tension headache is all about. Well, wait a minute. I didn't know Jesus ever got sick. No, He just got sick of the people maybe He was trying to deal with at times. And He got I don't know. But He knew what it felt like to be human. In fact, the book of Hebrews says, in Hebrews chapter 4 and verses 14 through 16, it says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest," that's Jesus, "who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points, tempted as we are, yet without sin." He knows what it's like to be human. He knows what it's like to be tempted. He knows what it's like to put up with difficult people. He knows what it's like to go to work every day. Remember, He was a carpenter before He was a preacher. He knew what it was like to have to get out of bed and be faithful to an employer. He knew what it was like to be a kid and grow up in a house with imperfect parents. He knew what it was like in all points, like we are, and yet without sin. And then it goes on to say there, it says, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." What that means is He said, you know, I know everything because I'm God, but since I became flesh and dwelt among you, buddy, have I experientially really gotten to know what it feels like to be human. And because of that, I have certain grace gifts that I can give you to help you make it through. Paul found it this way whenever he had sought the Lord three times to take away an infirmity of his flesh. He prayed, "Lord, take this illness from me." And the Lord said to him, "My grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in your weakness." If you think in your mind that God just doesn't understand where I'm at, I have gotten so much on my plate. The Lord knows that He will never give me more than I can take, but I'm pretty sure He might have forgot about that when it comes to me. I am so overloaded, I can't stand anything else. God gives grace to help in time of need because He knows what it's like to have a busy schedule. He knows what it's like to deal with people who are dependents. He knows what it's like to deal with an elderly mother. He knows what it's like to deal with all the points that we are suffering with as well. So what does it mean to have God with us? It means the Son of God understands what it's like to be human. Yes. And then in John chapter 14, verses 1 through 27, we find that Emmanuel, God with us, means that the Holy Spirit brings us comfort. God the Father loves us and gives us gifts. God the Son knows what it's like to be human and to be tested and tried and provides gifts. And God the Holy Spirit, in John chapter 14, verses 1 through 27, knows that God the Holy Spirit brings us comfort. And I'm just going to read that for you here. It says, Jesus says these words. He says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." He says, "For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." Wow. I mean, can I just stop there a second and go, wow. I've lived long enough on this earth to get so caught up in the affairs and responsibilities of this earth that sometimes I lose sight of the fact that there is an end to this life and something to look forward to in the future. All my life I've dreamed of living on that river, for instance. I may never live on that river in this lifetime, but there is a mansion for me. It's probably going to have a boat and a dock at the end of it when I get there. I don't know. And I don't care if it's a giant apartment building that we all get to live in a Father's house, as long as my apartment is as big as a mansion. That's all I care. But this is your inheritance. This is what God has for you if you make him your Savior. This is the comfort for those who are going through trying hard times, that there is an end coming and there is a judgment that will make all things fair and make things right again. And after that, there will be eternal life in a blessed situation. And no, you won't be sitting around playing harps and playing cards 1 million times and say, "What do we do tomorrow?" We will be ruling and reigning with Christ. What does that mean? I'm not even sure. Might have to do with other planets and galaxies. I don't know. But I know one thing, that there is a future that the half has not yet been told, the scripture says. And there is a heaven to gain as well as a hell to shun. That's good preaching, Pastor. All right. That's what we say. He says, "And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." See, this is the comfort of the Holy Spirit come through the words of Christ here. "There you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Well, Thomas, open foot, insert mouth, says, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, and how can we know the way?" Sounds like us. Jesus said to him, he says, "I am the way." There you go. "I am the way, the truth, and the life." So let me answer a couple of questions you haven't asked yet. Pilate's going to one day soon ask, "What is truth?" Let me answer that ahead of time. I am truth. You're asking, "What's the way?" I am the way. In case you haven't asked already, I'm the life too. Praise God. "No man comes unto the Father except through me," he says. Verse 7, he says, "If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him." Philip, who didn't learn from Thomas, pipes up and says, "What? Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us." Philip wakes up all of a sudden, hears something that interested him, and said, "What? God the Father's here? Where? Show him to us, Jesus. Show him to us, Jesus. And he says, "You've already seen him." What? God with us. Amen. Jesus. He says, "When you've seen me, you've seen the Father." You've seen Jesus, you've seen the Father. And so Jesus says in verse 9, Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long and yet you have not known me, Philip? Wow, he who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me, he speaks the words, does the works. Believe me, verse 11, that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly, I say to you that he who believes in me and the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these will he do because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And then he goes on and just clarifies, in case you didn't catch that. He says, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Now, that brings up a question, doesn't it? Christmas is coming. Could use a little extra cash, God? Got Christmas presents to buy. Not for me. Not for me. For all those I have to buy for. Lord, would you give me some cash? You said in verse 14, if you ask anything in my name, I'll do it. Do you know? Maybe so. Give it a try. Sometimes the Lord just gives people what they ask for, be simply because they ask for it in faith. But he says, if you ask anything in my name. Now, part of that is saying, Lord, we ask you these things in the name of Jesus, amen. Or in the name of Jesus, I come and ask you these things. It also implies the idea that if Jesus were here himself, would he ask for that? That's what in his name means. In other words, if you're asking for a new canary yellow Mustang convertible with a black top, 454 motor. Oh, that's a Chevy motor, isn't it, Paul? I'm sorry. 0 to 60 and fast enough to get you a ticket. You may or may not get that. But if you are asking for something that Jesus would ask for if he was here, he says, ask anything in my name and I'll do it. I think it's God's will that you be able to provide the gifts and stuff that you want to for your family. I think it's God's will that he provide all the needs for your household, whether that be patient bill collectors or whether that be ones that settle with you, or whether that means you financially planned well enough to be able to take care of those things ahead of time, or whether it's health issues, whether it's healing, whether it's relationship issues. I think that you can ask anything in his name and he will provide your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. This is the comfort that he provided for us by being with us. He says, ask anything in my name, I'll do it. Verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. It's kind of interesting you put those two verses together, isn't it? Ask anything in my name, I'll do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. He says, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper or comforter that he may be able to abide with you forever. Who? He says, the Spirit of Truth. The Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. The Holy Spirit was with them because it was the Spirit of Christ. He says, soon that Spirit will be in you, because now we pray a little prayer like this. Lord Jesus, would you come into my heart? Would you save my soul? Would you come into my life? Where is the physical man, Jesus, waiting at the right hand of the Father for the day where the Father says, go and return to the earth for the second time? That physical man is still in heaven, but his Spirit, the Holy Spirit of Christ, is what you ask to come in your heart and save you. It is he who seals you and your salvation unto the day of repentance. It is he who is in you, and so therefore he, Christ, the Spirit of Christ, is there to comfort you and to be with you while we're still on earth waiting for his return. It's a comfort to know that not only does he know what I've been through, he knows the pain and suffering and what it's like to be human, but he also is here to help us be victorious while we're waiting for him to return. He says it like this. He says in verse 18, I will not leave you orphans. He says, I'm leaving, guys. I'm going to be leaving here soon. I'm going to stand on a mountaintop on a mountain, and I'm going to ascend bodily into heaven, and you're all going to be standing there gazing at me go. And I'm not going to be back for a couple thousand years. Well, he didn't say that then, but we know that now. But he says, I won't leave you orphans in the meantime. I'm going to send my spirit to live with you in your hearts. Until then, I will not leave you comfortless. A little while longer and the world will see me no more, but you'll see me. What? We'll see you? A little while longer, the world won't see me, but you'll see me. Why? Because I live, you will live also. At that day, you will know that I am in the Father, and the Father and you in me, and I in you. Kind of confusing. Who? In my Bible, which you're not looking at right here, I marked verse 17 says, the Spirit who dwells with you will now be in you. And then he says, at that day you'll know that I am in my Father and you in me and I in you. Right where he said the Holy Spirit would be. What he's saying is, I haven't left you comfortless. My body left, my spirit still dwells in the earth and lives in your heart. And I'm comforting you through the knowledge of my word. Because in the beginning was the word. The word was with God, and the word was God. And he came to Emmanuel with us to come live with us, to bring us comfort. So he says, who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he also who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Then we go on to Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will not manifest yourself to us and you will manifest yourself to us and not the world? How are we going to see you and everybody else not? Jesus, by the way, he didn't learn from Philip and he didn't learn from Thomas. Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Make our home with him. God has made himself at home in our lives and in our hearts if we have received him. Let's make sure he feels at home. Let's clean the house up a little bit, maybe. Set some cookies out. Try to clear the air a little bit. Go to sleep and get sleep on time so not so grumpy with him. Company says it stinks after about 3 days. He said, I'm coming to stay, so you might as well just treat me like family. I'm going to be here a while. Amen to that. Jesus answered, said, if anyone loves me, he says, and keeps my word, my Father will love him. We will come into him and make our home with him. Verse 24, he who does not love me does not keep my words. And the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you, but the Helper or Comforter, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all the things that I said to you. And here's where I want to end off on this passage. He says these words. He says, peace I leave with you. Peace I leave with you. The Prince of Peace says, peace I leave with you. The one who said peace, goodwill to men, said, peace, my peace, I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. The word let means you have a choice. We have a choice to let fear, trouble, temptation, busyness, trials of life, lack, hunger, sickness overwhelm us. Or we can let he who came to take up residence with us and is now in us begin to drive the car of our life. begin to make the choices in our life that are going to bring healing and salvation and blessing. The Lord is with us. There's reason to believe for that. Let's just bow our heads and close your eyes just for a moment. I am blessed to be way ahead of time just for a moment. Let me take advantage of that just for a minute if I could. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if this is your Christmas season, and in this Christmas season you've forgotten about the baby in the manger who came to be God with us, and you need him to be not only in the season, but in your heart. You need Jesus to be in your heart. You need the peace that he brings. You need the salvation that he brings. If you've never asked the Lord to come in your heart and let his spirit come into your heart and save you, if you've never done that, I just want you to be able to pray a simple prayer of salvation with me. If the Lord's been speaking to your heart, I just want you to think about that. With every head bowed and every eye closed, just raise your hand and say, yeah, that's me. I think it's my time to ask Jesus to save me. Is that me? Just pray this prayer, simple prayer of salvation with me. Dear God, thank you for the gift of eternal life that is offered to me. I now receive it by accepting your Son Jesus as my Savior. And I invite you, Spirit of Christ, to come into my heart and into my life and to make me new. Help me to follow you all the days of my life and make a place in heaven for me. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, welcome to the kingdom of God. Welcome to the kingdom of God. Week after week, we get people who end up saying that prayer and from time to time say, yeah, now it's my time to be baptized. We had one of those last week. Someone raised his hand for prayer or salvation last week, got saved, got baptized the same day. So if you missed it, gone to be with family for the holidays is William, but praise the Lord for God, what God's doing in his life, and also, of course, for Gerald getting baptized last week. If you want to follow the Lord in believer's baptism, come see me, and the next time we'll do it, we'll include you in that, maybe at the new building. Man, that would be nice, yeah. Well, stand, if you will. I'm going to leave you with a blessing today. I'm just going to say a closing prayer, and then I'm going to give you that blessing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this word today. We thank you, Lord, that you are our comforter. You are the giver of gifts of eternal life. Lord, you are well aware of our weakness and our failings and have provided grace for every failing. We thank you that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one God who in three different ways of being manifest all work for our good. We thank you, Lord, for what you, all that means. Lord, we don't fully comprehend nor understand all these things. But as you reveal yourself to us, Lord, we most associate and most can connect with the one who came to be like us, our Lord Jesus Christ, who walked this earth in the dirt like we do, who got tired, got hungry, was tempted, was hurting at times, who lost loved ones, who struggled to put food on the table, who worked a living and a job, in all points, just like we are, yet without sin. Lord, let us strive to be like our Master. Let us strive, Lord, to live our lives in a way that's pleasing to God. Let us, like our Master taught us, learn to try not to sin so as to be pleasing to the Father. Let us obey your word that you have provided for us. And Lord, where we fail, when we fail, and when we need extra grace, would you send that grace? Even in this service, even in this moment, Lord, Lord, would you heal those of us who are sick? If you need a touch from God and healing in your body, would you just raise your hand as a testimony to God and say, yes, Lord, I want to receive that. Lord, would you just, for these that have raised their hand, God, would you provide the healing that we're believing for? By your stripes, we are healed. It's one of the benefits of you becoming flesh. And Lord, I pray for that healing to come to these bodies, for those raising their hands this morning, Lord. Let us hear miraculous testimonies of how God healed. And we thank you for that. Now, Lord, for relationships that need to be mended, what better time than at Christmas to restore relationships? Would you do that, we pray. Father, I pray that you would help us to be able to give and to find that it is more blessed to give than to receive this season. I pray that you would meet the need of everyone who's looking to find gifts for their children, gifts for loved ones. But Lord, may we remember that as we're giving to be like Christ, we also remember that it's really not about the gifts after all. It's about the love that causes the gift giving. And may we walk in that love this season. We thank you for this holiest of days, Lord, this Christmas time that is upon us. And may we always remember and keep Christ close in our hearts and remember the reason for this season. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you, especially this holiday season. May he lift up his countenance upon you, which is light, by the way, and give you peace. For you are blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed when you come and when you go, even if you're traveling for Christmas. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear? For who is like the Lord? No. Well, go walk in his blessing. Merry Christmas, everybody.
That's the cover for your microphone.